The 8th October 1963 was the eve of the first Uganda's independence anniversary in Kololo Airstrip. The pre- and post-independent Uganda only saw postal service for the protectorates of British East Africa and Uganda was called East Africa and Uganda Protectorates, which operated from 1903 to 1920. From 1948 to 1977, postal service in Kenya, Tanzania and Uganda was provided by the East African Posts and Telecommunications Corporation. With the decolonization of Africa, Uganda took over control of its postal system, although until 1961, stamps from the colonial postal system were being issued alongside Uganda's stamps. The Uganda Posts and Telecommunications Corporation had a monopoly over Uganda's communication sector until the Uganda Communications Act was enacted in 1997. The act created the Uganda Communication Commission, the current regulator of communications in Uganda. On independence in 1962, Uganda had one Radio Uganda and Posta as the only channels of communication. It was until 1963 that the Uganda Television was established. Ali Oduka, the first current affairs TV producer in the country, Haji Mayanja Njuchi, the Idi Amin Rain head of Presidential Press Unit, and Uganda Television veteran newsreader James Kunobwa recounts the moments where communication was a monopoly.
In this digital age, information flow is much faster. You can get news to move from one area to another quickly. You've got what they call now breaking news. Something can break out now and you shoot it and transmit it live from location. Unlike those days when you had to shoot on film, then you have to run back with it, edit it within the studio, and by the time it comes out, some hours late. With that, today's way of broadcasting is faster, quicker. But one thing which the journalist should do is see that he gets news which is very credible. He should not get only what he thinks. If you doubt a certain action, ask. Takes no, it does not hurt you when you ask. Not just what she lost, but more to bring a hope the world has
never come across before. I know how great things have really changed. Even the media itself has changed because now we have so many stations here and there. You no longer depend on UBC or on government aided. Media house. Each one was getting news from Ministry of Information as a sole, except for these small items. Car has knocked somebody, this and that. That one you wouldn't need any guidance from the ministry. Otherwise, all these big functions, definitely coverage was being done by the Minister of Information.
I'll tell you one thing, I don't know whether I would call it censorship, but I wouldn't personally call it censorship. We knew what to say. For example, let me pose one interesting thing. As a Ugandan, what do I benefit if I put out a story that hinges on damaging the relationship or of our neighbors? You know the results, you know the repercussion. Some of our people do not even censor themselves.
The media wasn't the way it is now. So you had to write letters, send the telegrams, the phones were not easy at the earlier stages. So it wasn't easy. Of course, that one now has changed. Everybody has a telephone. Even those who don't have, they have friends with telephone. The media has also changed. You can access information from anywhere in the world with these modern phones. So the flow of information is definitely different.
At the establishment of the Uganda Television, it was all in black and white signals until 1975, when the then President Idi Amin Dada directed that color TV should be brought to Uganda. Former Minister for Cooperatives Yonah Kanyomozi said he first saw a TV for the first time in Uganda after independence. Kanyomozi and his fellow students at the time wanted to lynch the then Minister of Information who had brought TVs in the country.
When I came back from overseas, I came back in 1966. Before that, there wasn't a TV at all. And when the TV started, the late Nikion was the Minister of Information. I think he got them from Japan or something. We as students, when we came, we were here. But we were looking at not the value of TV. We were looking at whether investment should have gone there instead of going to improve schools or hospitals or roads.
Telephones were also a monopoly of the state, as no mobile phone was in place at the time. The National Resistance Movement government liberalized the media to allow competition, which to the veterans was a move that was supposed to be backed by tight regulations.
I can see some people either too excited. I will quote you an example. You remember during the Iraqi war, when one British journalist disputed the story that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction. This reporter said, there is no way Saddam Hussein hasn't got weapons of mass destruction. And what happened to him? The man died. How? That he cut himself with a knife. They found his body lying, cutting himself with a knife. This is London. This is UK. UK. So surely my appeal to some Ugandans, not everything we see is really necessary for the public. Abaganda balina olugero olugamba eby'omunju tebitottolwa. Bingi bye tumanyi naffe, bingi nnyo nze bimanyi. Naye I ask myself, if I say this, what am I going to benefit?
There are occasional people who are on these medias, like even those who speak on the radio, speak on radios in various programs. My name is this, I stay, you know me, I started why you say, they would have been followed. Would have already had problems. I think Museveni is a little bit, President Museveni is a little bit softer on that one. Maybe he would be hard on the others, but Amin would not have allowed it.
You need it very much, and you need it as much as yesterday. Before you come into this field, you should have got that training. And the training from experts, not training on the field like most people are getting. You know, today people listen, or they have in their mind, let me scoop this story. Let me be the first to report. But the first to report in what manner? Is it credible? Is what you're getting a real story? Or is it just something which is your opinion?
We will take a very short break, but before I do that, let me first take you back in 1994 when President Museveni was launching SANU Television as part of the liberalization of the media strategy in Uganda.
...that houses the TV studios toward the facilities so far in place and switched on the studio lights to officially declare commencement of television broadcasting for this first indigenous privately owned television station in Uganda.
I'd like to thank SANU Radio and Television for responding to our decision to liberalize all sectors of our national life, including the economy as well as the media, by agreeing to set up this radio and television. They are helping in actualizing what we wanted to do all along. The reason being that privately owned enterprises are better managed because of the motivation of the people involved. So there are, we therefore hope that we shall get better service for the public by using the private people. So I thank you very much for responding.
Mr. John Kato is the director of Sanyu Television.
International Television Network was conceived and founded by Mr. Thomas Kato in 1992. It was his dream that one day he could own a television station where he could transmit entertainment programs to the Ugandans. The company is wholly owned by Ugandans and is fully, completely locally financed. In May 1993, government granted us a license to operate an FM radio station and a television station. The initial plan was to start off with a television station, but we realized that without some sort of knowledge of electronic media, it would be more reasonable to start with a less capital-intensive and human-intensive medium. That's the decision to start with Radio Sanyu. The guiding principles to our on our inception of this business were and still are to educate, inform, and entertain the public. Radio Sanyu began operating on the 18th of December 1993 as the first privately owned station and is to date the most powerful technically and most successful both with listeners and advertisers. After 10 months of broadcasting, we are now ready for the challenge of running a television station. Today, we employ 52 staff, three of whom are expatriates. The average age of the staff is below 30, and we are looking more at the youth and university leavers so that we can develop new minds in the modern way of broadcasting.